Tan Books presents The Passion, Reflections on the Suffering and Death of Jesus Christ. Written by Paul Thigpen. Read for you by Paul Thigpen, Kevin Gallagher, and Catherine Fowler Sample. Dedication.
For Francesco Mion, dearest friend, brother, and spiritual son. He who desires to go on advancing from virtue to virtue, from grace to grace, should meditate continually on the Passion of Jesus. There is no practice more profitable for the entire sanctification of the soul than the frequent meditation on the sufferings of Jesus Christ. Saint Bonaventure.
His blood be on us and on our children. An introduction.
My first crucifix, a gift from my aunt, was made of white plaster about a foot long. I was rather young, and the novelty of it fascinated me. I had seen such images only from a distance. I examined it carefully, running my fingers over each detail of the wounds, nails, and thorns. It was beautiful. But before long, I concluded that it was much too clean. Pulling out my box of watercolors, I painted it with bloody reds and purples dominating the whole. All in white, it seemed. The figure had looked like a ghost. Now, with livid flesh, he looked at last like a man, if a suffering one. Since that time, the sacred image of Christ on the cross has met me and challenged me countless times in church, on the walls at home, and in the homes of friends. Like millions of Christians through the ages, after years of familiarity, I still find myself strangely drawn to the crucifix to reflect on the agony portrayed there. And the images I find the most honest, I also find the most compelling. I mean the kind of dark, grisly crucifix, so beloved in Latin culture and so unsettling to our own. Why unsettling? I once heard a religion teacher in a parochial school complain about the crucifix. She insisted that the sight of a dying human being on an instrument of torture simply shouldn't be tolerated in a school or even a church. Too negative, she said. Too messy, too bloody, too disturbing. Think of the children. I do think of the children. And when I do, I also think of the broken, bloody world they inhabit, the same world into which their Savior came as a child, the same world that nailed him to that cross. I remember that they were born in blood, that they may well die in blood, and in the meantime, they will no doubt see a great deal more of blood. The question is not whether our children and we ourselves will be confronted with blood. Life itself is crimson stained. The question is this: what kind of meaning will we find in the blood? Will we learn that life is in the blood, as the book of Leviticus tells us? Will we know that forgiveness, healing, and grace are in the blood? Or will we believe the lies of our time, that blood is a mere commodity, cheap entertainment, or the never quite satisfied taste of revenge? The crucifix has much to teach us about the true meaning of blood, if we will only pay attention. A great deal of traditional Christian prayer and meditation has been precisely the attempt to pay that kind of attention. Such prayer dwells on the Passion of Jesus Christ as prophesied and foreshadowed in the Old Testament, preached and remembered in the four Gospels, interpreted and lived in the rest of the New Testament. The power of the Passion. The Passion is an immense thing, a supernatural and divine thing, and thus a dangerous thing. Understood, appreciated, and embraced for its own sake, genuinely, if never fully, it has the power to overthrow us, and overthrowing, to save us. Misunderstood, dismissed, or manipulated for a diabolical agenda, it still has the power to overthrow us, and overthrowing, to damn us. The history of the church provides ample illustrations of both kinds of encounter with the Passion. The Apostle Paul so deeply entered its depths that he bore on his body, as he said, the marks of Jesus. Yet he also wrote in tears of those he called enemies of the cross of Christ, Christians who confused and abused the message of Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection. The horrible pogroms against Jews across the centuries display perhaps most starkly the hellish outcome when people attempt to harness the power of the passion for selfish causes. Some Christians heard the sacred story and twisted it into a summons to vengeance against those they call the Christ killers, refusing to recognize that they had to include themselves in that wretched category. For them, the blood of Christ was not a costly and humbling invitation to goodness, but rather a convenient and explosive excuse for evil. Nevertheless, there were men and women in every generation who hid themselves deeply in the precious wounds of Jesus and found there the bloody womb for a new birth. The Spanish Franciscan Maria Coronel of Agreda and the German Augustinian Anne Catherine Emmerich were two such Christians. Excerpts from Scripture and from the works of these two women form the basis for the 40 reflections on our Lord's Passion presented here. Maria of Agreda, 1602 to 1665. Maria Coronel entered the convent in Agreda, Castile as a teenager and took the name Maria de Jesus. By the age of 25, over her protest, she was made abbess and, except for 3 years, remained the superior there for the rest of her life. During the time of her administration, the convent became one of the most fervent in all Spain, and she died with a reputation for great holiness. The cause for her canonization was introduced in 1762 by the Congregation of Rites at the request of the Court of Spain. Maria is chiefly known, however, for writing a book entitled The Mystical City of God, A Divine History of the Virgin Mother of God. Though the text focuses on the life of Mary, her life is intimately intertwined with that of her son. So the volume, in part, attempts to take us up close to the events of our Lord's Passion. The mystical city was first conceived 9 years after Maria became a nun, but written down 10 years later at the command of her confessor. She wrote the first part, consisting of 400 pages, in only 20 days. Her desire was to keep it from publication, but a copy was sent to the Spanish king, Philip IV. Later, in obedience to another confessor, she tossed the book and all her other writings into the flames. Then, in 1655, a third command of her spiritual director caused her to start again. She finished the project in 1670. The mystical city is presented as a record of special messages from God, received in contemplation and revealed in mysteries that tell the life of Mary. It overflows with elaborate detail, describing both interior and exterior events, beginning with the Virgin's conception and extending to her coronation in heaven. As soon as the text found a public beyond Spain, it provoked a fierce storm of controversy. It is not difficult to see why. Read as a precise theological treatise, a reliable historical account, an accurate scientific text, or even an exact record of what Maria heard and saw in her visions, the book presents numerous problems. She herself had been reluctant to see it published, perhaps sensing that the visions were intended more for her personal reflection than for public dissemination, and that much of what she saw and heard, as she often put it, was indescribable in the first place. Difficulties were compounded by several factors: claims that Maria's confessors had tampered with the text, political tensions between France and Spain, theological debates between the Franciscans, her order, and their philosophical rivals, and certain mistranslations and misinterpretations of the original Spanish by non-native speakers. In general, the book was widely praised and approved in Spain, but condemned elsewhere. Anne Catherine Emmerich, 1774 to 1824. Anne Catherine Emmerich entered the Augustinian convent at Agenettenberg, Dulmen, at the age of 28. Since childhood, the supernatural realm had seemed ordinary to her. She frequently experienced mystical visions and displayed extraordinary gifts. She predicted certain happenings accurately and could hear and see remote events. When the sick came to visit her, though she had no medical training, she could diagnose the causes of their problems and prescribe remedies that worked. Nevertheless, her own physical condition was frail and troublesome. The sisters
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.